Welcome to another family Bible study. Isn't it remarkable that as we are doing this study that we are seeing how history repeats itself? On the one hand, we are learning here about the difficulties that the Apostle Paul is in. As a matter of fact, he was part of the difficulty until God finally really worked him over on the road to Damascus. He was intensely upset by the beginning of the church age that began in his time. And then when God made him a new man and he joined the church age, then he came under the same difficulties that he was creating when he was still a Pharisee. Namely, the fact that he is being harassed, he is being threatened with death, and that we're finding is a dramatic picture of exactly what's happening today, as God again is shifting the focus from the church age to the sending forth of the gospel outside of the churches. Which the Bible also calls the latter rain, as the gospel comes down from heaven like rain to water the earth. So now we're going on with this chapter, and we'll see once where we go next.
Notice that in verse 7, before the judgment throne of Festus, we're back in Acts 25, verse 7, when he was come, the Jews which came down from Jerusalem stood round about and laid many and grievous complaints against Paul, which they could not prove. You see, this is the final question. If we listen to the churches, they are saying, but we are right. That is, the churches are saying that they are right, that they have the truth. And yet they can't prove it. They can't prove it. When they have doctrines, and we talk about these again and again, doctrines that I've already mentioned, faith is an instrument, or baptism is a seal, they have a free will gospel, or they believe in the 1,000-year reign of Christ, the doctrines are legion out there that will not square with the Bible, and yet they insist this is truth. This is really what family radio ought to be teaching. I have to admit that down through the years there's been a constant pressure on family radio: you've got to teach this, you've got to teach that, which the majority of the churches did teach, and we have resisted that, because it is not what the church teaches, it's what does the Bible teach. And we're only glad when teaching is faithful to the Word of God. And then notice Paul's answer, and we also get an insight as to the character of the accusations that were laid against him. In verse 8, Paul answered for himself, "Neither against the law of the Jews, neither against the temple, nor yet against Caesar, have I offended anything at all." All right, now there are three major accusations here. First of all, the law of the Jews. What is the law of the Jews? Well, the law of the Jews is the Word of God. The law of the church should be the Word of God. It should be the Bible. We're not talking about the wrong doctrines or the wrong practices that have been introduced through the thinking of theologians, but we're talking about the Bible itself. And this is where we have to examine ourselves. Are we being faithful to the Word of God entirely? Because that ideally is the law of the Jews. It is the law of the church. Because Christ has established the church that has existed during the past 1900 years. And it's not talking about traditions and the cultural ideas or the things that have crept in as mankind thought it would be a good idea to do this or to believe that. No, we have to remember that the law of the Jews, the law of the body of believers, the Jews here representing all believers, the law of the Jews is the Word of God. And that is where we are being judged. We're being examined. Are we going to be implicitly faithful? Secondly, notice that they made a charge that he was against the temple. Neither against the temple. Now in the New Testament, what does the temple apply to? Well, first of all, Christ said, I am the temple. Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will rebuild it. But we also know, of course, that the body of believers, which is the body of Christ, is the temple. And so the task of the believers as they bring the gospel cannot be against the body of believers. Think what a terrible thing this is. And fills me with dismay when a church will teach, tonight is the hour of decision. Tonight you can decide and become a Christian. And so pretty soon at the end of an impassioned address of some kind, you go down to the front and you are instructed to pray the sinner's prayer, O God, have mercy on me, I'm a sinner. You're instructed to invite the Lord Jesus into your heart, and you do all of these things, and you do it gladly, and you do it with some emotion. And then you are told, now you are a child of God. And you walk out of that place, walking on cloud nine, walking on air. I'm a child of God. I'm saved. Glory, hallelujah. I am saved, and the whole thing has been a man-made salvation. It had nothing to do with God Himself giving you a brand new resurrected soul. It had nothing to do at all with a gospel that features the fact that only God can do the saving. He has to do all the work of saving, and we can't do anything to get ourselves saved. And yet that person has been victimized. He has come under the idea, all is well with my soul. And I tremble when I think about this, as we read Matthew 7, where it says, there will be many in that day that will say, Lord, Lord, did we not do many mighty things in your name? Did we not prophesy? We were a faithful witness in your name. And then will come the shocking, shocking answer from the Lord Jesus, who is the judge of all the earth. Away with you, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. I think of the terrible disservice that parents are being given. They have their children baptized, and they're led to believe that that somehow has brought that child under the covenant. And somehow now that is going to be instrumental in initiating the salvation or guaranteeing the salvation of that child. And what a terrible, terrible thing. Because it is not true. It is not true. No water baptism can ever, ever initiate or bring anyone closer to salvation. It is only a shadow. It's part of the ceremonial law. Just like the burnt offerings and the blood sacrifices and the circumcision of the Old Testament. And yet these parents are being victimized by this. They are led to believe things. I remember talking to an old man, elderly man one time, a dear friend of mine. His son was had gone astray, totally astray. And yet he said to me, you know, but my trust is he has been baptized. He was baptized as a baby, and so everything is going to be all right. Everything is going to be all right. He had no understanding that that water baptism didn't do anything at all. It was a sign pointing to the fact this is what has to happen. Our sin, that this baby's sins have to be washed away. And if they are, even as this water washes away dirt, and if his sins are washed away at some point, that is, if this person, this child, either as a child or as an adult, actually becomes saved, if God in his mercy will save that child, then indeed what has been hopeful in employing the sign that indeed that person will have had all of his sins washed away. And so as we bring the gospel, we have to be honest, altogether honest. Oh, I remember the first time years and years and years ago I was on the open forum, and of course I didn't understand a lot of things as I understand them today, and I fell into that snare. Somebody said, oh, I desperately want to become saved. And so I started asking questions. Do you love? Oh, I love the Lord. Do you really trust him? Do you believe that he is your Savior? Oh, I believe he is my Savior. And then I asked him, and you believe that you're a sinner and that he can forgive? Oh, I know I'm a sinner. Then about that time, I woke up and I thought, now, wait a minute, you're walking into a trap. Because the next thing you're going to say, well, you meet all the qualifications, you must be saved. And how do I know whether that person was saved or not? And I caught myself in time and backed away from that line of reasoning, because we can emotionally and intellectually say these things and believe these things, but that isn't salvation. Salvation is when God does that mighty work of giving us a brand new resurrected soul. And the evidence is not that I'm able to say with passion and with conviction, oh, I know Jesus is my Savior. I love the Lord Jesus. Oh, I love the Lord Jesus. That's not the evidence. The evidence is, are you keeping his commandments? Is there an earnest, ongoing desire in your life to do the will of God? And which would be have to be the evidence produced when you have received a brand new resurrected soul. Incidentally, it surprises me sometimes when I find what the doctrines the church doesn't understand. I remember I've been talking about a brand new resurrected soul for years and years and years, and I had a friend who was a Bible school professor, you dear man of God. Oh, he loved the Lord, and we had a lot of talks together. But he says, you know, I always get uncomfortable when you talk about a brand new resurrected soul. And I said, well, why shouldn't I use that language? Haven't we been raised with Christ? Well, no, there's been a seed that's been planted and has to be nurtured. Well, you know, ask a question. Here's a little baby that's 10 days old, and can God save that baby? Yes, God can save that baby. And then the baby dies at 12 days of age. How much time has that seed to nurture? Or maybe that baby died 20 minutes after God had given it a brand new resurrected soul. No, I'll tell you, when we become saved, it's an instant thing. We receive a brand new resurrected soul. It's significant, you know, in 1 Corinthians 15, when it talks about the resurrection of our bodies, it doesn't say, well, and then after a little while, I'm going to slowly give you a resurrected body. God uses the language in verse 51 and 52. In an instant, in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, we suddenly have a brand new resurrected body, and we are caught up to be with Christ in the air. And if that's the way he gives us a brand new resurrected body, that's the way he gives us a brand new resurrected soul. Now, we don't always see the outcome of that immediately. There is a development sometimes. It takes a little while to show up, and we may not know immediately when we have become saved. This is God's business altogether. Well, and so the fact is, as we are being judged, don't forget that. We are under judgment. We're judged by the Word of God. Are we being faithful? Are we being faithful? Just as every church is judged. And if we're not faithful, God will wipe us out. I'm convicted. I'm utterly convicted. Please forgive me for keep talking about family radio, but that happens to be a big part of my life. And the fact is, I'm convicted that the moment we're not faithful to the whole counsel of God, we're done. God will wipe us out. We might have a lot of money, or we might have a lot of prestige in the world, but insofar as being used of God as an instrument to bring the gospel to the world, it won't happen. It will not happen. We'll be done. We have to remain faithful, and we have to continue to faithfully bring the whole counsel of God. Now, the third accusation, first of all, it was against the law of the Jews. Secondly, against the temple, which is the body of believers, those who are to become saved. And thirdly, it is against Caesar. Notice this. Nor yet against Caesar. Now, in the political situation, obviously, rebellion against Caesar was anarchy, and you could be sentenced to death immediately. But in the spiritual setting, remember that Caesar is a representative of God Himself. When we are faithless, when we are not careful as we bring the Word of God, it is against the law of God. It is against those who ought to be benefited by the law of God. But worse than that, it is against God Himself. It is against God Himself. It is an offense to holy God. And we, when we read Philippians chapter 2, verse 13, where it says, "Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling." With fear and trembling. We should tremble before God as we recognize that He's a consuming fire and that sin should bring damnation. And it's only the mercy of God, only the mercy of God, that is, that His damnation is not being visited upon those who do become believers. But by the same token, as we handle the Word of God, this is God's Word. This is God's Word. This is not just any old book. This is a very holy book. It isn't accidental that they put on their Holy Bible. It is God's Word, and it has to be handled with great care. And that means that those who dare to be a witness or dare to bring the gospel, whatever we witness, whatever we preach, whatever we teach, we want to spend plenty of time knowing that this is what the Bible teaches. Never, never, never do we want to fall into the snare of preaching something or teaching something or witnessing something that's out of our own minds or that is out of the minds of people. We've got to know it is from the Word of God. And we never can study the Bible enough. Now, it doesn't mean we're going to do it perfectly. Now, please don't misunderstand me. You know, we all have feet of clay. There will be times when you'll be witnessing to someone and you will make a statement that you think about it later on and you think, "Wow, I should never have said that. I said more than the Bible would allow me to say. I was trying to give an answer when they asked a question, and when I should have said, 'I don't know,' I tried to give an answer and I gave a wrong answer." And then wonderfully we can go to the Lord and repent. This is the chastisement that comes, the horror feeling that we have that we didn't do that properly. And the same is when we teach or preach or we can go to the Lord, oh Lord, forgive me, I didn't do that right. And but we will make correction because we dearly love the Lord and we want to do it God's way. Well, that's as far as we're going to get. Next time we're going to go on with verse 10, and we're going to see how that Paul is going to end up for sure at Caesar's judgment throne, and we're going to ask just why has God put that information in there. And then pretty quick we're going to get into a King Agrippa and his sister Bernice, try to figure out what spiritual lessons God has for us in this. This is not easy material. This is very, very difficult material, and I'm trying to be as faithful as I can to the Word of God, and I think so far I think we're right on track. But shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we thank Thee that we've had this opportunity to look again into Thy Word. Now, Father, there are a lot of things in Thy Word we don't like. We don't like to read about Thy judgment, Thy wrath being poured out upon ancient Israel. We don't like to read about Thy wrath being poured out upon the church, the New Testament Israel. We don't like that at all. And yet, Father, we know that Thou hast given us Thy Word, and we better listen to it. Oh, Father, may we be more and more faithful to Thy Word. We pray that as we study the Word, as individuals in this congregation, or as teachers, or as a pastor, those who preach, whatever it may be, oh Father, may it be that we may be altogether faithful to Thy Word. And oh Lord, forgive where anything that is taught is contrary to Thy Word. Father, bless now, we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.